Debates on motions with no legislative effect. The motion debate on implementation and continuance of one country, two systems. Members who wish to speak in the motion debate will please press the request to speak button. I now call upon Mr. Dennis Kwok to speak and move the motion. Mr. Dennis Kwok. Thank you, Mr. President. Mr. President, I move that the motion as printed on the agenda be passed. Mr. President, political behavior is about the right time and opportunities. Last week, some members walked out of this chamber at a particular moment, indicating that the right moment is important. And this motion debate is to take place a week after the vetoing of the constitutional reform package. I think this is most appropriate for discussing this issue. After the vetoing of the constitutional package, many people are already considering how to take constitutional reform forward. There is this saying that the constitutional package is a test for one country, two systems. That may not be the case. Hong Kong people choose not to accept the constitutional package, not to accept NPCSC's decision on the 31st of August. This indicates that Hong Kong people have the right and freedom to say no. This time, the constitutional package has caused us to reconsider a number of issues because many remarks made by the CPG and the white paper, frankly, manifest their understanding and attitude towards one country, two systems. However, what the CPG said, is it equivalent to what Hong Kong people understands as one country, two systems? Is it the same as the original intent of Mr. Deng Xiaoping when he first raised the concept of one country, two systems? If the constitutional package is in front of us, Hong Kong people really have to think about the prospect of one country, two systems. The basic law is the specific manifestation of one country, two systems. So we must understand the intent and purpose of one country, two systems. Articles 1 to 3 of the basic law say that after the return of Hong Kong to China, we should have a high degree of autonomy. And Articles 4 to 8 say that Hong Kong's freedom and rights are protected. The original capitalist system, the common law system, etc., will remain unchanged for 50 years. All these articles reflect the original intent of one country, two systems. That is to prevent, after the handover, the mainland systems affect Hong Kong. We have to maintain our core values as well as civil rights and freedoms. Hong Kong's systems have to be protected by the basic law, just like our judicial system. And basic law, Article 22, subparagraph 1, says that no department of the CPG and no province, autonomous region, or municipality directly under the central government may interfere with the affairs which the Hong Kong SAR administers on its own in accordance with this law. Now, this has not been changed since the promulgation of the basic law. Mr. Deng Xiaoping's remarks are also not to be changed. That's a historical fact. But are our systems representing the original intent of the basic law? Are they the same as what Mr. Deng Xiaoping considered as one country, two systems under the basic law? After the handover, the CPG interferes more and more into Hong Kong's domestic affairs, from officials to political parties, etc. We have less and less press freedom. They are more and more inclined to the central government. same with the liaison office. This explains why Hong Kong people's confidence in one country, two systems has dropped from the peak during the handover to now. Again, it's a matter of timing. When one country, two systems is weaker and weaker, and Hong Kong people's confidence is weaker and weaker, am I heading towards the reverse direction in promoting this motion of implementation and continuance of one country, two systems? But this is the best of times and the worst of times. We still have 30-odd years to go before 2047. I think this is the most opportune moment to resolve the issue. If we are to implement one country, two systems, we have to grasp the opportunities. We have to make use of the time available to rectify the deviations. Just 2 years ago, Mr. Justice Lee and Mr. Johannes Chan from the Law School of the Hong Kong U brought out the issue of the future of one country, two systems. The legal profession is particularly sensitive about this issue. As a representative of the legal profession, I respect laws and systems. If institutional problems emerge, the first thing we need to consider is not to destroy it or drive it away, but to improve on it. If the system is to continue to operate, we have to consider how that can be done. And better still, we should create a better future. Under one country, two systems, we should rectify deviations. We shouldn't damage it or give it up. Before and after the handover, public confidence in the basic law was quite good. The provisions in the basic law themselves don't have huge problems. The problem lies with understanding and execution. Originally, between the central government and Hong Kong, we can identify a set of implementation details. From the promulgation of the one country, two systems and the drafting of the basic law, the central government invited all walks of life to participate. At that time, Hong Kong people trust the basic law and one country, two systems, so they're willing to go back to the mainland. However, in this post-constitutional reform period, we should seriously reconsider the matter. Under one country, two systems, it's not true that the side with more powers can alone see to it that implementation is smooth. The most important reason is that when we explore the future of one country, two systems, the central government should go back to the original intent of one country, two systems. That should be our foundation, our consensus, and platform for communication. It's also the starting point of a healthy cycle. When we had controversy on constitutional reform, many people voiced out about one country, two systems. My horizon and wisdom are limited. Among all the views aired, I can only see one feasible way out. That way is not easy. That is to implement and continue with one country, two systems, and to bring it back to the original intention. That is the only feasible way out. I move this motion in the hope that we can explore the implementation and continuance of one country, two systems. I now propose the question to you, and that is that the motion moved by Mr. Dennis Kwok be passed. 6 members will move amendments to this motion. This council will now proceed to a joint debate on the motion and the 6 amendments. I'll call upon Members who move amendments, Mr. Ip Kin-yuen, Mr. Ip Kwok-him, Mr. Lee Cheuk-yan, Mr. Gary Fan, Mr. Martin Liao, and Mr. Wong Yuk-man to speak. But they may not move the amendments at this stage.
Mr. Ip Kin-yuen. Mr. President, the 1st of July 1997, the baby is born then, and on the 7th, on the 1st of July 2015, we'll have their 18th birthday. Hong Kong has been reunited with the mainland for nearly 18 years. Yet in this council, we do not have a genuine democratic system as a gift to the 18-year-olds. As I said in an earlier debate, in the Nordic countries, Greenland of Denmark and Åland of Finland had more than 100 years of autonomy, and we should take a lead from that. There is development in the autonomy, and there must be objective conditions. Say the two are mutually dependent. The national identity of the members of the autonomous region must have some common experience, and the maintenance of autonomy relies on the system and actual communication and respect in order to solve problems and resolve conflicts. With regard to one country, two systems, one country is to deal with sovereignty and identity, and two systems is to retain the original conditions for the people of Hong Kong. Before reunification, we called it maintaining of the original lifestyle of the people of Hong Kong. After reunification, we called it retaining the core values of Hong Kong. Whatever you call it, we want a high degree of autonomy, and a high degree of autonomy requires that in the system there should be some sort of guarantee. As for the past 18 years, there is no easy road for the people of Hong Kong. A series of political and social issues have caused us to be very worried whether the core values of Hong Kong would be gradually taken away, and Hong Kong's luster will become dim. Hong Kong people were worried, are worried. As for one country and two systems, they are the foundation to protect their lifestyle and also basic human rights. The well water, river water will not border with well water. There is the boundary. There are two differences between the two systems, and there is also communication, and there are links. The success of one country, two systems depends very much on whether we can implement one country, two systems, high degree of autonomy, and the basic law. There's a clear definition. In a high degree of autonomy, we have administrative power, independent court of final appeal, legislative power. Apart from national defense and diplomatic affairs, other things should be fall within the scope of Hong Kong people ruling Hong Kong. They should be dealt with by the people of Hong Kong. In the past, the CPG and the liaison office were very adopted a very low profile. They did not interfere with Hong Kong affairs. They didn't interfere with Hong Kong affairs. They carefully avoid towing, crossing the boundary. But the boundary is getting blurred. Central government interfering with Hong Kong affairs, that is very obvious, and the SARG has followed the instructions of the CPG. Just last week in this council, there was an incident. The pro-establishment waited for Uncle Fat, didn't cast a vote. Afterwards, some members went to the liaison office and gave explanations and asked for forgiveness. And this liaison office also gave commendation to some members of the council. The liaison office play a very important role. Why is it so important? You know it. This situation is very different from the one. Is this situation very is not in conflict with one country, two systems. The success of one country, two systems is to find a suitable balance and have mutual respect. The basic law should be should provide the balance. Now, the basic law provides that our rights, our original lifestyle will be protected, but after some period of time, after some time, we found that there are changes. Say, for example, in the education sector, we have also seen this, and therefore I move this amendment. In the academic freedom of the education institutions, we have seen there is interference and threat, and we see that our human rights situation is going down, and we begin to doubt whether one country, two systems have become not effective. Is it the Hong Kong which we used to know? The people of Hong Kong has lost confidence gradually in one country, two systems. In my amendment, I add academic freedom, safeguarding academic freedom and educational institutions autonomy in order to express concerns. It is provided very clearly in the basic law, but starting from 2000, the year 2000, we saw the Robert Chung incident, a number of cases in which academic freedom and the freedom of educational institutions have been interfered with. Earlier this year, the UGC announced that in 2014, the research grant report, before the announcement of the report, it was a confidential report, yet secrets were disclosed, and then it was reported by the leftist newspapers, and then Professor Johannes Chen was being criticized and queried and attacked by leftist newspapers, and the situation continued. Yesterday, with regard to the post of Vice Chancellor, the university is not able, the Senate is not able to make, the council was not able to make it, has yet to make a decision. The council doesn't have the courage to cast its vote. A series of incidents, including the acceptance of donation by Professor Tai, and also the attack against Professor Johannes Chen. Is there any political consideration behind the scene? We are worried. Recently, those who participated in occupation or peaceful occupation movement, Dr. Xiao, after being elected as the deputy chief of a research institution, but he was regarded by his superior as being too political and would affect the independence of the research center, and asked Dr. Xiu to give up the post. We do not understand all the details of the case, but the incident has caused people to worry that Dr. Xiu's political participation affects his academic appointment. I have to stress that the appointment of teaching staff or teaching research staff of universities should not be affected by political participation or political inclination. Otherwise, it will be kind of political suppression. Now, the academic institutions are interfere with. Article 137 of the Basic Law may be diluted, and this article will gradually disappear. Education is within the autonomy of Hong Kong. The policy here should not be interfered with. Yet, Chen Zhuora gave his comment that the Secretary for Education should be subject to the supervision of the CPG, and the Education Bureau should give directions to school sponsoring bodies. This is worrying, indeed. Under the basic law, only the SARG is directly accountable to the CPG. The directors of bureaus are only accountable to the CE. Of course, they will take into account the view of the CPG. But in terms of the setup, in terms of the system, there should not be any bypassing. Otherwise, the CPG can just bypass the CE and interfere directly with local affairs. On this point, what we should do is to adhere strictly to the provisions of the Basic Law. The Basic Law should not be amended lightly. Last year, the State Council issued its white paper. It's another example. Your time is up, Ms. Ip.
Mr. Ip Kwok-him. Mr. President, today I'm moving an amendment to the motion, mainly to rectify the wrong content of the original motion. The original motion says that the SARG or the central government has not been implementing and continuing with the policy of one country, two systems. In fact, we've always adhered to the one country, two systems concept. But somebody intentionally and unintentionally mislead people into believing that the central government is interfering with the internal affairs of Hong Kong. According to the Basic Law, the central government has overall governance of Hong Kong, including the NPC decision to establish a special administrative region to promulgate the Basic Law and to amend the Basic Law. The Standing Committee of the NPC can also interpret the provisions of the Basic Law, amend the methods of selecting the Chief Executive and the Legislative Council. The NPCSC has a supervisory role to play. It has decisive power, even to delegate new powers to the SARG. The central government can appoint the CE and the principal officials and to take care of foreign affairs and to delegate designated powers to the CE. To put all these in simple terms, although Hong Kong enjoys a high degree of autonomy, Hong Kong is not enjoying full autonomy or total autonomy. The NPCSC can exercise its power to interpret the Basic Law. For example, children of Chinese nationality born of non-Hong Kong locals, how should they be handled? And the methods for selecting the chief executive and returning the Legislative Council can also be amended and modified when statutory interpretation is required. The NPCSC can exercise its constitutional power. It is not interfering with the internal affairs of Hong Kong or damaging the high degree of autonomy enjoyed by Hong Kong. So we've always been implementing one country, two systems. The pretext is to be in compliance with the interest of the CP and Hong Kong. So I am amending the motion not just to rectify the wrongful contents of the motion. There's another purpose, that is to ask the SARG to accurately do publicity and education on one country, two systems and the Basic Law among the public, particularly young people, so as to ensure that there's a correct understanding and comprehension. Now, protests and demonstrations should be conducted in a gradual and orderly manner. However, recent demonstrations have neglected our statutory provisions. Some people even advocate for Hong Kong independence, disregarding national and local security. They do not admit that Hong Kong is part of China. This is worrying. This is alarming. Some people oppose the anti-Northeast development, the parallel goods traders, and so forth. In the demonstrations against the development of anti-Northeast, some people hoisted the colonial flag. And for the anti-parallel goods traders campaign, we also saw the colonial flag as well as banners to ask Chinese people to go back to China. And there are other similar slogans. As for the 70-odd-day Occupy Central movement, the organizers and participants had been using self-determined destiny as the theme. The Occupy movement was unlawful, and the power of the CPG to govern Hong Kong was also doubted. And recently, some people doubted the provisions of the Basic Law, even though just one or two provisions were in question. Some people even burned the Basic Law to vent their anger. At one mass rally, representatives of students from four university students burned the Basic Law on the spot. Such behavior is not desirable and has brought forth a very adverse impact on one country, two systems. The Basic Law is an important constitutional document of Hong Kong. It's only with the Basic Law that we can implement one country, two systems, high degree of autonomy, and Hong Kong people ruling Hong Kong. Hong Kong people very preciously treasure such systems. But then these people burnt the Basic Law. By burning the Basic Law, they're actually burning this very important document that protect our autonomy and one country, two systems. The opposition did not point out the erroneous behavior of the students. They condoned the students, rather, in burning the Basic Law. It's just like condoning the radicals in violent attacks. Now, such mistakes may be aggravated. In the past, when the SARG publicized the Basic Law, they emphasized rights and neglected responsibilities. They emphasized two systems instead of one country. So they're criticized by all walks of life in Hong Kong. I seriously hope that these recent happenings in recent years can sound an alarm to the SARG. The SARG must enhance its Basic Law publicity among members of the public, particularly the young people, to ensure that the original intent of one country, two systems is accurately understood in Hong Kong. As for Mr. Lee Cheuk-yan's amendment, he asked that the SARG uphold the autonomy of the SARG and protect Hong Kong's core values and basic political, economic, social, and cultural rights. Of course. But what about the destruction brought forth by the Occupy Central movement? The core values were affected, including the spirit of the rule of law, the economic and social stability, and so forth. Mr. Lee Cheuk-yan's amendment disregards the fact that the CPG has full power to govern Hong Kong. He criticizes the CPG for interfering with Hong Kong's affairs. That's totally not correct. The DAP will oppose the amendment. In the drafting process of the Basic Law, lasting 4 years, 8 months, Hong Kong people had actively presented their views, so we took care of the opinion and concerns of all sectors of the community. So the Basic Law can withstand challenges. Certain issues were unforeseen, we can resolve all those under the basic law. We cannot, just because of the narrow interests of certain parties, readily amend the basic law. So the DAP will oppose Mr. Wong Yuk-man's amendment. Mr. Martin Liao's amendment has affirmed the past work of the SARG. That is very similar to my views and DAB's views. So the DAB will support Mr. Martin Liao's amendment. As for the other amendments, the DAB will oppose them. Thank you.
Mr. Lee Cheuk-yan, just now, Mr. Ip Kwok-him seems quite worked up about students burning the basic law after a protest. Well, it's going to be the 18th anniversary of reunification, and we still have 32 more years of 50 years of unchange. We've just passed the one-third mark. It seems Ip Kwok-him was quite worked up. He was quite angry that the students burned basic law. But have you thought about why they burned the basic law? Why are they so dissatisfied? Why don't you deal with that? It's not just about being a youngster that you're angry. It's about they're angry. It's the anger is from a whole generation, our younger generation. They're angry about the change in the one country, two systems, in that the one country overrides two systems. And the two systems are under threat, unprecedented threat. That's why I want to point out 2 points in my amendment. That is the responsibility of the central authorities, because they incessantly interfere Hong Kong's system. That's why Hong Kong people are worried that the Hong Kong system may come to an end with the central authorities' interference and intervention. The second one is whether Hong Kong people have sold the Hong Kong system out in order to please central authorities. And I think we need to have a fresh discussion in Hong Kong whether there is incessant intervention from the central authorities and how Hong Kong people can do in the face of such intervention. Of course, the loyalists will say that no, central authorities have always respected the basic law and there is no intervention. But look at it in two perspectives. First, what central authorities said, and look at their acts, what they say. Look at the white paper and what it says. Well, it's blatant that it moves from one country, two systems, and high degree of autonomy to a blurred line. It says that Hong Kong central government has has an overall jurisdiction over Hong Kong. So, and they also change from Hong Kong people ruling Hong Kong into Hong Kong people administering Hong Kong. Another thing is also from the white paper that is the high degree of autonomy is subject to the level of central leadership's authorization. There is no such thing called residual power. So, you have however much autonomy the central authorities give you. And it also says that they will stick to patriotics administering Hong Kong and exco members, LegCo judges, and the people who administer Hong Kong will have to abide by the basic law, and they have to protect sovereignty, development interest, and also national security. And being patriotic is the basic requirement. You require judges to be patriotic. But in their terms, being patriotic is to ensure national interest, development interest, as also sovereignty and national security. Then who will be there to protect the two systems?
if judges are there to protect the one country, who's there to protect two systems? So the entire white paper is only about one thing, that you have how much power the central authorities give you. You can't say anything. And we're at their mercy as to when the power will be given and when it will be taken back. Some people may say that, well, central authorities will abide by the basic law because it has been clearly stipulated. But in practice, what we see is worrying. Will the central authorities really stick to the basic law? And on constitutional reform, definitely not the case. That's why in the question for oral answers, the Lau Kong Wah just wanted to shift the responsibility of the vetoing onto Plan Democrats. He didn't say that the August MPCSC decision has gone beyond the basic law, and the five-step mechanism is also beyond the basic law. Do you remember what Lu Ping said, that the selection method in the for CE in the future is to be decided by the LegCo, but now it's changed to a decision made by the MPCSC, and then for the legislature to endorse. Originally, they only have to endorse it, but now they decide on how it should be amended. So it is not in compliance with the basic law. There is another example. Chen Zhuo said that the Education Bureau will have to be supervised by mainland authorities. So will the power be taken away from us? Because it says it's to be given by central authorities. And Wang Jiangya said that it's a hardliner. He said that it's for central authorities to decide whether you can enter the stage or exit the stage. And he even said that you have to pay, that people will have to vote them out. You have to pay with your vote, then you will be kicked out. And there is a chorus of pro-Beijing media. We have shrinking freedom of the press and freedom of assembly. Our freedom is shrinking, and apart from intervention from central authorities, well, it's actually all right if we are together to resist that intervention. Unfortunately, a lot of Hong Kong people sold our two systems out and sold our high degree of autonomy out. And before I elaborate, I would like to say what Mr. Chris Patton said in 1996, and I read it out in English.
This community's autonomy could be given away bit by some people in Hong Kong. We all know that over the last couple of years, we have seen decisions taken in the interest of the whole community lobby against behind closed doors by those whose personal interests may have been adversely affected. That is damaging to Hong Kong because it draws Chinese officials into matters which should fall squarely within the autonomy of Hong Kong. If we in Hong Kong want our autonomy, then it needs to be defended and asserted by everyone here, by businessmen, politicians, journalists, academics, other community leaders, as well as by public servants. 主席, 彭定康1996年講, 現在就是他講, bit by bit.
And Chris Patton talked about bit by bit. Hong Kong people, for their own interest, sell Hong Kong out. And we see it very clearly. The loyalists sell Hong Kong out. And they act like parrots. They want to introduce the National Security Act. They want to support Article 23. Central authorities give us the bogus universal suffrage, and the loyalists said that they support that. And they trample on Hong Kong people's dignity when they have made a mistake, when they blundered with only 8 votes for the motion. They immediately went to the liaison office to apologize. Well, yeah, well.
After going to the liaison office, you have to go for the wake on Thursday. It shows that you are responsible, you're accountable to liaison office and not to Hong Kong people, but you're not the first to do it. It was CY Leung, because after the election, he went to a liaison office to thank them for their support. So very often it's Hong Kong people who have sold Hong Kong people out for their own interests, because they can be rich if they shine the shoe. If they shine the shoe of central authorities, and that's why, and they are the people who ruin Hong Kong's one-two system.
Mr. Gary Fan, one country, two systems, high degree, Hong Kong people ruling Hong Kong, high degree of autonomy, is the promise by the Beijing government. In 1984, it was a promise made to Hong Kong people, to UK, and also even to the world. Hong Kong people were worried that after Beijing took over, Beijing will change Hong Kong's lifestyle, our regional lifestyle, and our systems. One country, two systems, and the basic law is the realization of this local, is manifestation of local consciousness. And this is also a promise for 50 years and change, and that made the British government and some of the people of Hong Kong accept the handover of sovereignty. With the handover of sovereignty, Beijing has been challenging Hong Kong people's bottom line for defending one country, two systems. Hong Kong people felt that they were unhappy about Beijing's failing its promises. The football fans just booed when the national anthem was played. In the year 2002, when the Chinese national team and won the chance of the World Cup finals, at that time the people of Hong Kong was very glad. The people of Hong Kong were very, very happy. But this change in of public sentiment is a very important indicator. In the year 2000, there was Article 23 legislation, but it went into a shipwreck. And since then, Beijing government has been interfering with the affairs of the SARG. It trampled one country, two systems underfoot. It requires there is one country over two systems in all areas of our governance and our daily lives. They have taken away they try to destroy our core values. With the assumption of CY Leung to power, Beijing become more frequent in its intervention, and therefore the people of Hong Kong rise up against this intervention. Under Article 22 of the Basic Law, please, it is said that the levels of the level of the government, the levels, different levels of the central government and the provincial government, autonomous region, etc., may not interfere with the affairs of SLG. But according to Cao Erbao, he said that there should be two ruling teams. One is the team of the governance team of SLG, and the other team is the liaison office and also HKMAO, which were also responsible for looking at governing Hong Kong. It seems that now they are looking up to the team, the governing team of mainland officials. After CY Leung was chosen, he went to thank the liaison office. And after the pro-establishment councillors had a serious blunder in this council, they went immediately to seek forgiveness, crying for forgiveness from the liaison office. The liaison office interfered with local governance and also different levels of elections in Hong Kong. June last year, the Beijing government redefined one country, two systems by publishing the white paper and putting one country above two systems. It goes against the understanding of the people of Hong Kong. It explains how they interpret the basic law to put Chinese system over our common law system. The rule of law has become the rule by law. quoting Mr. Lin Xingji, Mr. Lam Hangji, the Chinese constitution, which is which gives priority to socialism, is put above the basic law. NPC delegates, the government officials of Hong Kong have just are just listening in and obeying the law and the law commission of the mainland. They just listen to Beijing. They succumb to the will of the CPG, and they don't respect fairness and justice under the common law. The Beijing government has stretch the basic law in whatever ways. The three-step arrangement for political reform is changed into five step, and they imposed the decision of August in August last year. The former director of MAO, Liu Ping, said that after the year 2007, the development of democracy would be entirely within the local autonomy of Hong Kong. Beijing government will not interfere with that. But the fact is that before the rules, before the start of the game, has been changed in whatever ways, and there is no fairness in the competition. Hong Kong used to uphold the rule of law, and therefore we do not accept that. Beijing puts sovereignty first, and therefore the one-way permit system has become a floodgate for our population policy. During the drafting of the basic law in the community, it was already the opinion that Hong Kong should be given the power to grant one-way permit. Therefore, paragraph 4 of the article 22 said that Hong Kong could determine on the number of settlers. But according the Beijing has the power to interpret the basic law, and it stretched the meaning to the extent that only the mainland has the power to approve the people migrating from the mainland to the Hong Kong. Even their provincial governments have the power to approve their people moving to Hong Kong. Hong Kong, under one country, two systems, is deprived of the power to approve the immigrants. Beijing government wants to repeat its population policy in Tibet. It tried to change the population structure in Hong Kong. They tried to undermine one country, two systems. They know that people have not won the heart of the people of Hong Kong. Therefore, they threaten the people of Hong Kong. They try to brainwash children through the education system, but they are not successful. Therefore, they employ their population tactics to change our population through the one-way permit system. Hong Kong's economy is gradually incorporated into the five-year plans of the mainland. In the 12-5-year plan, a separate chapter was was given to Beijing, to Hong Kong and Macau. And in the 13-5-year plan, Hong Kong is asked to provide imports to the mainland. The five-year plan is entirely the work of the mainland, which is a socialist planned a socialist economy. Without consultation, they stealthily change our system. That is a disrespect of the two systems. In politics, in economic affairs, in social affairs, the Beijing government raise one country above two systems. Hong Kong people are discerning, and they are angry about it. After the umbrella movement, after the rejection of the political package proposed by the SARG, Beijing and the SARG have lost the confidence of people of Hong Kong. They have lost the future generation. Their policy of wooing people, Hong Kong people, back to the mainland have failed. They should reconsider their Hong Kong policy. They should implement the one country, two system according to its original spirit. 2047 is the end of the undertaking of 50 years and change. Former Chief Justice Ms. Andrew Lee said that Hong Kong had to decide on the future one country, two, resolve the problems arising from one country, two systems. One country and two systems are equally important. The New Democrats are of the view that the Beijing government has to recognize that one country, two systems are equally important. Beijing must adhere to the original spirit of one country, two system, maintain the difference, adhere to Article 22 of the Basic Law, and does not interfere with the local affairs of Hong Kong. And the Hong Kong people should decide on their own the democratic future of people of Hong Kong. Hong Kong people should be allowed to determine their fates so that our divided society can become peaceful. Thank you, Mr. President.
Mr. Martin Liao. Mr. President, one country, two systems is what the central government is promoting as a policy. At first, it was for resolving the Taiwan problem. Later, it was first used to resolve Hong Kong's reunification issues. The 12 fundamental objectives of the CG is to establish an SAR in Hong Kong, which will enjoy a high degree of autonomy in terms of legislation and administration. And the CE can be returned by election or consultation. And Hong Kong can maintain its status as a free port. Immigration documents can be issued, press freedom, freedom of publication, etc., are also maintained. All these rights were set out in the 1984 joint declaration between the UK and China. When the Basic Law was formally promulgated, the objectives and policies of one country, two systems were institutionalized and written into our laws. That is the only protection of our rights. Everything is clear and well-founded. All the objectives and policies have been realized. Hong Kong is now 18 years into its reunification with the mainland. Our original style of life has been maintained. That is full proof of the implementation of one country, two systems. It is strange that the original motion disregards all these and disregards the fact that the Basic Law is a document to institutionalize all the policies and objectives of the central government. Rather, the motion asked the SARG to invite the central government to implement and continue the state policy of one country, two systems, giving people the impression that the motion is very dissatisfied with the central government's deviation from one country, two systems. That's not a fact and is not the feeling of the 7 million Hong Kong people from day to day. To rectify these wrongful concepts, I'm moving the motion to clarify the situation. Between the SAR and the central government, the one country, two systems has always been adopted. That's a fact. We support the two governments to continue to implement one country, two systems. At the moment, many people have been very narrow-minded when looking at one country, two systems. They advocated for a federal system. They disregard our country system as well as the one country, two systems concept. All sorts of funny ideas emerged. Maybe they believe that one country, two systems only benefits one side. They think that Hong Kong people can get whatever they want. And when they don't feel happy, they cry out loudly that they've been cheated. Recently, the central government sincerely wished that Hong Kong can have constitutional progression. And the NPCSA decision on the 31st of August has laid down the framework for universal suffrage. However, these people say that that's fake universal suffrage. They insisted on civic nomination. Last week, I mentioned all the details. I won't repeat them. I have to point out that the Basic Law is a solemn state document. We should not follow subjective views in amending it. This time, the constitutional package was vetoed. We don't know when it will come again. This is the result of those who do not respect the Basic Law in One Country, Two Systems. The duty, the liability is not on the central government. What is the original intent of the One Country, Two Systems concept? Your original intent or my original intent? The capitalist system and lifestyle should be maintained for 50 years. That's a tool to maintain stability and prosperity of Hong Kong. But why should Hong Kong continue to be prosperous and stable? That's for the overall interest of the whole country.
This state policy to maintain prosperity and stability of Hong Kong did not start in 1913. It started when the PLC was founded. The PLA could have taken back Hong Kong back then, but they stopped at the Shenzhen River. Why not? It's not because they lack the military power. Rather, the central authorities there had the strategic decision to make full use of Hong Kong for the long term. Back then, they could only rely on USSR, Pakistan, and Hong Kong to break the blockade. Through Hong Kong, which was a free port, could get the necessary resources and also earn half of its foreign exchange income through export. For the sake of his own trade return and the interest of colony, that was also the position of Britain. In 1950, the United Kingdom was the first country to recognize PRC. With the opening up of the country, Hong Kong has all along played a unique and important role. In the early days of opening up of the state, Hong Kong provided the necessary technology, assets and resources to China or to the mainland, and Hong Kong is also the best platform for renminbi to go global. In 1997, the British government decided that the time was ripe, and the country decided to resume its sovereignty in Hong Kong under One Country, Two Systems. So the central authorities wanted to adopt strategies and policies that suit Hong Kong well to ensure Hong Kong's prosperity and stability. This position has never been changed since the founding of the PLC. The reason why we have One Country, Two Systems is for the interests of the country, and it's also a critical consideration as to why this should continue. One Country, Two Systems is unprecedented. As its chief architect, Deng Xiaoping, said, when it comes to implementation, there might be hiccups, but One Country, Two Systems itself is full of life. It is important that Hong Kong should respect one country and uphold the values of two systems. Hong Kong people may want to put its aspirations to the central authorities, but they must consider whether these aspirations are in the interest of the state. If there is any conflict, then it should be properly rationalized. While we fight for our aspirations, we should not do it at the expense of the state's interest. This is just a very simple logic. Unfortunately, there are people who have failed to understand this or turned a blind eye to this. Our democratic development is now stagnant, and unfortunately, there are people who have deliberately prolonged this political bickering. It's just like the amendments we have for this motion. While some consider the sovereign sovereignty of the state as a way to interfere with our affairs. And some would want to set up a committee to for constitutional amendment. I think they have turned a blind eye to one country, two systems, and they are actually hurting the core interests of Hong Kong and one country, two systems. In this post-constitutional reform era, I urge the whole community to focus its energy on improving our economy and livelihood. We should uphold our core values, and we should respect one country and defend two systems as we implement this principle. Thank you.
Mr. Wong Yuk-man.
Thank you, President. President, I'm in favor of direct rights in 2010, I proposed the 5-district referendum. It was heavily criticized by the Chinese Communist Party. One of the so-called crimes was Hong Kong independence. Last year, I proposed that we should reenact the basic law. And the royalists also accused me of Hong Kong advocating Hong Kong independence. The media and the political parties controlled by CCP criticized localism and localism groups, and all newspapers follow suit. If we want to have real self-determination in Hong Kong people ruling Hong Kong, they are regarded as heresy and must be nipped in the bud. My proposed amendment reads, that this council urges the SAR government to request the CPG to implement and continue the state policy of one country, two system in Hong Kong in accordance with the original intent of one country, two system, and to allow Hong Kong people to exercise the right to self-determination and establish a constitutional amendments convention on Hong Kong affairs to amend the basic law so as to lay down a direction for constitutional development that meets Hong Kong people's aspiration and realize genuine Hong Kong people ruling Hong Kong. 2 years ago, I proposed this. Most people thought that it was wishful thinking. Or well, I proposed that the CE should reside and that there should be a housekeeping government run by the directors of bureaus. And we have the 35 directly elected members with other academics on constitutional development should form the convention. And we should define what is foreign affairs and we should enact a law on political parties, and we should have laws regulating the receipts of donations by political parties. And when legislative members or proposers bills that touch on government policy, there should be no need to seek the consent of CE, and we should have public nomination in a universal suffrage system for the election of CE, and also for there should be universal suffrage for legislative elections. So people thought I was crazy, but people must have ideals. If you know ideals, you don't have any wish for growth. We must have self-determination. In the 80s, there was the discussion between Britain and PRC, and then there was the preparation committee and the drafting of the basic law. None of that was done under the authorization of Hong Kong people. And with the introduction of the fake universal suffrage constitutional reform package, it was vetoed by this council. The SAR government has been saying that it would like to implement universal suffrage, but the fact has spoken, and that is there will be no public authorization. In the past 17 years, one country, two system is just something on paper. We must have a real self-determination of Hong Kong people ruling Hong Kong so that we can have a long-term stability. The basic law was drafted without authorization of Hong Kong people, and the CCP has amended the annexes 1 and 2 in the name of interpretation. It has changed the constitutional system for the election of CE with the promulgation of the August 31st decision and the debacle in relation to the constitutional reform package. CCP has failed to observe the rules that it has promulgated. We are going to see more and more constitutional crises. Hong Kong will be ungovernable. We must have a new direction for the to amend the basic law so that we can have genuine Hong Kong people ruling Hong Kong. On the 23rd of June, there was an article published on the internet saying that a colony cannot have the power to amend the basic law. The article is meant to criticize those who are advocating the amendment of the basic law. These proponents are criticized as if it's just a casual move. Mr. Lee Cheuk-yan has usurped the proposal to achieving universal suffrage. And he was once a member of the Frontier. And Mr. Leung Yiu-chung is also here. I welcome any response they may care to make. Constitutional reform has everything to do with our survival. And I have already said that there should be massive protests and no cooperation movement to pave the way for constitutional reform. Unless we do something drastic, there will be no improvement. Dr. Chen Yun has advocated the protection of Hong Kong through the adoption of traditional Chinese culture. Some people are just repeating what I have been calling for constitutional reform. Well, in that article that I've just talked about, it said that these proponents are trying to get a way out by invoking public opinion. Well, I advocated the referendum, but it was scheduled because people did not want to sacrifice. Well, this is something we need to do, and a lot of sacrifice is required. You may be imprisoned, or you may lose your life. All these proposals are considered conservative by young people in Hong Kong, including my proposal. In the early 1980s, I tried to take out some old articles and editorial that I wrote in the 80s, and some articles that about the Sino-British negotiation, and some other articles about the basic law. The thing that I want to say is that I told you so, that nothing changed. The whole setup remains the same. According to standards espoused by Hong Kong young people, what I propose is also considered conservative, and the promise of no change for 50 years has proved to be unreliable. Well, it was thought that we would just change the flag. The Chinese flag would fly, and then we would have a notion, a notional presence of a garrison, and then we can have self-rule. If this CPG continues with its high-handed approach, there will be more resistance, and the entire the next generation would not stomach it. When the governance crisis transforms into political crisis, at the end, Hong Kong would be lost. Well, I've heard other members who talk about the CPG a lot. And I recall those members who cried after the debacle. Why did they cry? Well, because you are scared of the CPG. And Mrs. Regina Yip cried. Well, Well, she was such a strong character. Why did she cry? Well, she was scared. That's why. With regard to the amendments moved by the Mr. Ip Kin-yuen, Mr. Ip, Lee Cheuk-yan, and Mr. Gary Fan, I support the spirit and I will support them. Mr. Ip Kwok-him's amendment is about brainwashing, and Mr. Martin Liao's amendment is about the continuation of the state policy of one country, two systems. But he has forgotten that on the 31st of August, or the 26th of August last year, there was the white paper published by the State Council saying that the CPG has full authority over Hong Kong. So I would oppose to those amendments.
Secretary for Constitutional and Mainland Affairs. President, the People's Republic of China is a multicultural country practicing unitary state system. Under the unitary state system, the administrative regions are regional administrative regions set up by the central authorities in accordance with needs. Under Article 31 of the PRC Constitution, the state may establish special administrative regions when necessary. The system is to be instituted in the special administrative regions shall be prescribed by law enacted by the National People's Congress in the light of specific conditions. The Article 62 of the Constitution provides for the establishment of certain institutions, including the institution of the special administrative region. The Basic Law Preamble provides that upholding national unity and territorial integrity, maintaining the prosperity and stability of Hong Kong, and taking account of its history and realities, the People's Republic of China has decided that upon Hong Kong's resumption of the exercise of sovereignty over Hong Kong, a Hong Kong Special Administrative Region will be established in accordance with the provision of Article 31 of the Constitution, and that under the principle of one country, two systems, the socialist system and policies will not be practiced in Hong Kong. In accordance with the Constitution of the PRC, that the NPC hereby enacts the Basic Law of the Hong Kong Special Administrative Region of the People's Republic of China, prescribing the systems to be practiced in Hong Kong SAR in order to ensure the implementation of the basic policies of the PRC regarding Hong Kong. It shows that the Constitution and the Basic Law provide for the system in Hong Kong. This is not the same as a federal state where the after delegating the authority, there is residual power, and this is a different system. Under the Basic Law, Hong Kong's Special Administrative Region is or comes under the Central People's Government, and there is no layer between them. According to the constitutional status of the Hong Kong SAR, the central authorities have the constitutional power to provide for the system in Hong Kong SAR, including the political institution. Mr. Dennis Kwok's motion is to earnestly invite the central government to implement and continue the state policy of one country, two systems in Hong Kong in accordance with the original intent of one country, two systems. I must solemnly point out that the design of the political system in Hong Kong has to do with the sovereignty of the country. and also the implementation of one country, two systems in Hong Kong. The SAR doesn't have the constitutional status or power to unilaterally change the system designed for Hong Kong. Also, in the original motion, it implies that Mr. Kwok doesn't have any confidence in the central authorities abiding by one country, two systems. And this skeptical attitude is uncalled for, and it is not in line with reality. In Mr. Gary Fan's amendment, he talks about the one country, two systems and the problems there, and it's also erroneous. Since the establishment of the SAR, the mainland authorities have been assisting or supporting the chief executive and Hong Kong SAR to administer Hong Kong in accordance with the law under one country, two systems, Hong Kong people administering Hong Kong, high degree of autonomy and the basic law. Mr. Martin Liao's amendment reflects the fact that the central authorities and the SAR government have been practicing the basic law in accordance with one country, two systems. Under Article 1 of the Basic Law, Hong Kong Special Administrative Region is an inalienable part of the PRC. Article 2, the NPC authorizes HKSAR to exercise high degree of autonomy and enjoy executive, legislative, independent judicial power, including that of final adjudication in accordance with the provision of this law. Chapter 2 of the Basic Law provides for the relationship between the central authorities and the Hong Kong SAR. It provides that Hong Kong practices a high degree of autonomy. Since the reunification, both the central authorities and the SAR government have been acting in strict accordance with one country, two systems, principle, and the basic law. Mr. Raymond Wong's amendment proposes that the basic law be amended. I must emphasize that the basic law is a constitutional document for the Hong Kong SAR. It implements one country, two systems, Hong Kong people administering Hong Kong. It is the cornerstone in safeguarding the long-term prosperity and stability of Hong Kong. It took about 5 years for the basic law to be drafted. It is a document that took a long time to complete, having regard to the comprehensive situation in Hong Kong and various views in Hong Kong. Hong Kong enjoys some judicial independence, and the basic law does respect that. Overseas institutions and the business community do have very high opinion of Hong Kong's judicial independence. People of different political persuasions do have to respect and abide by the basic law. To argue for amendment to the basic law in an arbitrary manner is unreasonable and infeasible. Article 159 of the basic law provides that the right to amend the basic law is a matter for the NPC. Mr. Raymond Wong referred to the amendment of the basic law and the constitutional amendment convention on Hong Kong affairs, totally disregard the constitutional status of the basic law. It is unreasonable, nor is it legitimate. So the SAR government resolutely against Mr. Wong's amendment. Under the protection of the basic law and the support of the country, Hong Kong has always been enjoying double advantages under one country, two systems. Unlike other provinces and municipalities, the SAR government is authorized to deal with external affairs in terms of economy, trade, finance, shipping, communication, tourism, culture, and sports. Hong Kong can unilaterally maintain and develop relationship with international organizations in the name of China-Hong Kong. For instance, Hong Kong has already had air services agreement with 64 jurisdictions, buttressing Hong Kong's position as an international aviation center. We have entered into CDTAs, or the Comprehensive Double Taxation Agreements, with 32 jurisdictions. And these provide added advantages and incentives for investors to make investment in Hong Kong. Since reunification, we have entered into visa-free agreements with 42 jurisdictions. At the moment, 150 countries and regions are offering visa-free arrangement or on-arrival visa arrangement for SAR passport holders. Under the basic law, Hong Kong is a separate customs territory. The Hong Kong SAR can use the title Hong Kong China to take part in the GATT, later becoming the WTO. We can also take part in the textile agreement arrangement, including the favorable trade arrangements. Furthermore, the SIPA has further expanded Hong Kong businessmen's trade opportunities in the mainland. All these go to show that under the protection of the Basic Law, Hong Kong does enjoy the double advantages under one country as well as two systems. Hong Kong's position as an international financial and shipping centers have been strengthened. The Basic Law provides for stability and provides a cornerstone for prosperity and stability for Hong Kong. It provides all manner of freedoms and liberties for Hong Kong people. Articles 3, 5, and 6 of the Basic Law provide for freedom of speech, press, publication, assembly, association, demonstration, and so on. Under the Basic Law, Hong Kong people do enjoy the right to movement, religious belief, marriage, and organize unions and strike. Mr. Lee Cheuk-yan's amendment urges the SAR government to be courageous to refuse the Beijing authorities' intervention in Hong Kong affairs, to uphold the autonomy of SAR governance, and to strive to safeguard Hong Kong's core values and protect Hong Kong people's basic political, economic, and social and cultural rights. I must point out that under the Basic Law, Hong Kong people's rights and duties are safeguarded. The central authorities and the Hong Kong SAR government have been dealing with Hong Kong affairs in strict accordance with the Basic Law. So Mr. Lee Cheuk-yan's allegation in his amendment is incorrect, and we find this unacceptable. The Hong Kong SAR government has been acting in accordance with Articles 136 and 137 of the Basic Law to maintain academic freedom and institution autonomy. So Mr. Ip Kin-yuen's allegation in his amendment that there are signs that one country, two systems is being severely challenged, especially in safeguarding academic freedom and educational institutions autonomy, and this simply doesn't stand. Mr. Kwok-him's amendment urges the administration to mount publicity regarding one country, two systems at the basic law. We absolutely agree with that, and because this is terribly important. The government has been promoting the basic law to make people aware of the details of the basic law, to equip people with a better understanding of the document. We're going to do more of the same going forward. President, as I said earlier, since the establishment of the Hong Kong SAR, the central authorities and the SARG have been acting in accordance with the basic principle of one country, two systems, Hong Kong people administering Hong Kong, a high degree of autonomy, as well as the basic law. As regards Mr. Dennis Kwok's original motion, and Mr. Gary Fan, Mr. Ip Kin-yuen, Mr. Lee Cheuk-yan's amendment, and also Mr. Raymond Wong's amendment regarding self-determination and constitutional amendment convention, they disregard the background of the basic law and also the fact that Hong Kong is an inalienable part of the PRC. They disregard the fact that the basic law has over the years brought about prosperity and stability for Hong Kong. So the SAR government resolutely objects to Mr. Kwok's amendment, as well as the amendments moved by Mr. Ip, Mr. Lee, and Mr. Fan and Mr. Wong. I urge members to do likewise. With these words, I conclude my speech.
You.
Mr. Xin Chung-kai.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy. I speak to support Mr. Dennis Kwok's original motion and Mr. Ip Kin-yuen's amendment, and to oppose Mr. Ip Kwok-him's amendment. I support Mr. Lee Cheuk-yan's amendment. I abstain when it comes to Mr. Gary Fan's amendment. I oppose Mr. Martin Liao's amendments. Mr. Deputy, the original motion is very straightforward, and that is to request the SAR government to earnestly invite the central government to implement and continue the state policy of one country, two systems in Hong Kong in accordance with the regional intent of one country, two systems. I think the wording itself is very straightforward, and the original motion shows that there is some departure from the original intent of one country to system when it comes to implementation by the central authority, because in June last year the white paper on one country two systems were published. It contained several dozens of pages, and one sentence was very shocking. It said that the central authorities would exercise its full power to rule Hong Kong effectively. From the drafting and promulgation of the basic law, one country, two systems, and one country, two systems, Hong Kong people in Hong Kong with a high degree of autonomy has all along been stressed. And according to the Secretary, in Chapter 2 of the Basic Law, the relationship between the central authorities and the SAR are very clear. Article 22 of the Basic Law reads, no department of the Central People's Government and no province, autonomous region or municipality directly under the central government may interfere in the affairs which the Hong Kong SAR administers on its own accordance with its law. If there is a need for department of the central government or for provinces, autonomous regions or municipalities directly under the central government to set up offices in the Hong Kong SAR, they must obtain the consent of the government of the region and approval of the Central People's Government. And I will not continue to read the article. Before and after the handover, well, we can see that the central authorities have been interfering into the affairs of Hong Kong. In 2003 and 2004, there were the rallies and also the discussion of legislation to implement Article 23. And then there is the question of two ruling teams in Hong Kong, and also this practice of one country, two system policy in the Hong Kong SAR published in seven languages. So there are examples abound. to show that the central authorities have interfered with the two elections in Hong Kong, district council elections, electoral elections, not to mention C election. In fact, our C was ordained by the central authorities. That's why the original motion urges the administration to invite the central government to implement and continue the state policy of one country, two systems, hoping that interference into Hong Kong business can be a lesson and that they can respect our autonomy. In fact, when it comes to diplomatic matters, we have every respect for the central authorities, but when it comes to matters within our autonomy, I hope that the central authorities can give us full respect, in particular in relation to Article 22. I must explain why we oppose two amendments here, in particular the amendment by Mr. Martin Liao. We believe the current situation is far from desirable and it must be rectified to lessen central authorities' interference into Hong Kong matters. In particular, some state organizations in Hong Kong are interfering with Hong Kong's business. I have received complaints from colleagues that the central liaison office would call up legislators here to ask them how to vote. And this is one example of interference. And regarding Mr. Wong Yuk-man's amendment, I will also abstain because, as said by some colleagues, we respect the basic law. We agree to the one country, two systems principle in the basic law before and after the handover. In particular, before the handover, the DP supported one country, two systems on the basis of the basic law. Of course, we are unhappy with the constitutional part in the basic law, and if there is any proposal to amend this part of the basic law, we will support it. Therefore, we are not going to support Mr. Wong Yuk-man's amendment because he talks about setting up a constitutional amendments convention. Now, if it is just a forum for discussing how the basic law should be amended, then of course we believe that we can discuss how the constitutional part of the basic law can be discussed. But having heard Mr. Wong Yuk-man's speech, I believe that the convention will go beyond that scope. As regards Mr. Gary Fan's amendment, we'll also abstain because according to Article 7 of Annex 1 of the basic law, is very clear when it comes to the C election. Well, we used to have a three-step process. Now it is a five-step process, and C election must be approved by the MPCSC. Following the practice of Annex 1, we cannot determine the pace of democracy in Hong Kong. So we have to amend Annex 1 first in order to do that. There are 115 articles in the basic law. To amend it, we need a two-thirds majority support in this council and also support from two-thirds of the local deputies to the MPCSC before that can be done. Your time is up. Mr. Albert Ho.
Thank you. In 1997, the country resumed sovereignty over Hong Kong and decided to implement one country, two systems and to maintain our capitalist system and way of life for 50 years. Meanwhile, there are a few important arrangements. First, the Hong Kong SAR will be allowed a high degree of autonomy to manage internal matters of Hong Kong. And secondly, the central authorities would resume as a power over matters such as foreign diplomatic matters and also defense. And under Annexes 1 and 2 of the Basic Law, the central authorities can exercise some powers and also the power to appoint principal officers in Hong Kong. And Chapter 2 of the Basic Law is the relationship between the central authorities and Hong Kong SAR. And this chapter sets out powers to be exercised by the central authorities. So I just set out the constitutional arrangement that's based on some very fundamental objectives and policies. First, the design of the basic law is such that the system of delegation should enable Hong Kong to fully exercise its administration, judiciary, and legislative functions so that we can maintain an intact system, an integral system, so that we can maintain our way of life and our capitalist system. To this end, the Basic Law has set out very clearly that the central authorities should not interfere into the internal matters of Hong Kong, and therefore Article 22 of the Basic Law states categorically that no department and province or autonomous region or municipality of the central government may interfere into the affairs of Hong Kong. These matters are within the high degree of autonomy of Hong Kong, and it's entirely a matter for Hong Kong. And for Article 45 and 68, it is clearly specified that the ultimate goal is to return the legislature as well and to elect the CE by universal suffrage as early as 2007 and 08 respectively. Another objective and strategy of the Basic Law is we uphold human rights in accordance with international conventions. Article 39 of the Basic Law has clearly adopted the International Convention on Civil and Political Rights, the International Convention on Economic, Social and Cultural Rights, and the International Labour Conventions. So that's the original intent of the Basic Law. That was the original intent when 18 years back we had high expectations, hoping that those constitutional arrangements would be sincerely and solemnly implemented. Unfortunately, 18 years have elapsed. The central authorities, in recent years in particular, have time and again gone back on its words and damaged these constitutional arrangements. Directly, they have interfered or allow interference into our internal matters. Even for voting in this council, Chinese liaison officers constantly rang up legislators, asking them how to vote. A very good example was when we had to decide on whether a subcommittee should be set up to look into Si Wai Leung's role in a tendering exercise, and also to look into the licensing issue of free TV licenses. And some legislators even received phone calls from the Chinese National Office, and they were given a talking to afterwards. And then for the C election, it was even more blatant. Si Wai Leung had to go and thank the Chinese liaison office the next day after his successful election. And the Chinese liaison office has also blatantly interfered into our own administration. Chao Bao said that there were two governance teams in Hong Kong, and Kopi Chen said that he talked about our electoral arrangements, and Chen Zuo'er, I think he was authorized by the central authorities to supervise the performance of our education officials. And Zhang Rongxin, he published this white paper, and it was clearly set out that there should be full governance by the central authorities. And for the electoral reform, first, there was interpretation of the Basic Law, and then in the second of the five-step process, almost by means of legislation, the MPCSC has restricted the mode of universal suffrage for election of the CE, and the 831 decision deprived us of our voting rights. To return to the original intent, the central authorities or the MPCSC must be self-restrained. It should not arbitrarily reinterpret the basic law. It should not interfere into the internal business of Hong Kong. It must honor the international covenants, and then we must also restart the five-step process.
This is Wong Lee Cheuk. Mr. Deputy, I support Mr. Dennis Kwok's original motion. According to the original arrangement, these motions should have been debated before we voted on the electoral reform package. But because of the filibustering on the budget, we can only deal with these today. If the debate was held before the voting, I'm not sure what difference it would make to the vote. Maybe people would have a better grasp of the one country, two systems principle. Some may argue that it is a little bit too late for us to talk about this subject. That much I agree. The failure of the electoral reform is because there is a gap between the basic law and people's understanding of the basic law. On Article 45, there is mention of the universal suffrage, and I think there is a chasm in the understanding. If we do not face up to this issue, even if we reactivate the five-step process, if people do have a gap in their interpretation and understanding of the basic law, I'm sure that we're going to be repeating what we saw, and we will be suffering from a standstill. We have to understand the nature of one country, two systems. It is a compromise for reunification. It could have been one country, one system. Why did we practice one country, two systems? I think we have to ponder over this issue. Mr. Deputy, the basic law is a constitutional document. I'm sure the constitutional scholars would agree that a constitution is a contract between the country and its people. From this angle, the basic law is the contract to implement one country, two systems. In other words, both sides will have to act in accordance with this agreement, and nobody should flout the provisions there. If we subscribe to this, you cannot say that I can flout the provisions, and you cannot, if we deal with the issues, in particular the electoral reform, if we pursue this kind of line of thinking, there is no way we can come to any consensus. So we have to ask ourselves, hand on heart, whether we have flouted the provisions of the basic law. Some argue that the basic law is not worth the paper it's written on. We have to tear it up. We have to burn it. Some argue that when it was drafted, I wasn't born. I wasn't part of the drafting. So I want the whole basic law to be redrafted, and I think these arguments are really controversial or doubtful. A lot of legislation was drafted when we were not before we were born. Should we tear up these legislation? The answer is no. Whether a piece of legislation is justified or not is controversial. Like a civil litigation wounding, one has to file lawsuit within 3 years. Sometimes we cannot do so within 3 years and cannot get the compensation. This may not be be just, but the fact is the piece of legislation is there to safeguard the accused if after 10 years or more than 3 years we pursue the matter, it will not be fair to the accused. The law may not be fair, but we have to consider both sides of the equation. Some said that the basic law is unjust. But I would like to ask, which provision in the basic law do you think is unjust? Chapters 1, 2, and 3 ensure that under two systems, Hong Kong can develop. Our human rights, liberty, judicial independence are safeguarded. Our freedom of speech is safeguarded. We cannot obliterate this. We cannot airbrush these out of the basic law at all. I did say that Article 45, we have to make sure that the electoral reform has to be in accordance with Article 45, and it is accepted by the constitutional experts. So under this provision, Hong Kong can practice a universal suffrage, and this doesn't actually go against the basic law. Why do we have to stir up the controversies here? The other thing I'd like to say is that people find it unjust, not because of the provisions, but the interpretation of the provisions on both sides and the way it is implemented. And this is causing the ire of either party. So what we have to change is not so much the spirit of one country, two systems, or the provisions, but the concept, the understanding of these provisions. Why do we have the conflicts, and why do we have confrontation when looking at these provisions? These are the issues that we have to face up to. So I think that We would have, after the veto, a bit of breathing space so that we can have some understanding of these issues. That's why I set up this platform, the Path of Democracy. This is precisely the reason why I'd like to gather more viewers in order to manage the expectation. And that way, we would be in a better position to secure genuine universal suffrage. Mr. Yu Siwing, Mr. Deputy, after the reunification, the mainland authorities practice one country, two systems, and high degree of autonomy. This is really unrivaled the world over. We have to have faith in the mainland government. It is only through mutual trust that we can take full advantage of the advantages in the mainland and maintain long-term prosperity and stability in Hong Kong. I mean, it may sound very simple. The UK ruled Hong Kong for more than a century, and Hong Kong people embrace the Western values. Under the educational system, a lot of Hong Kong people, and particularly the young people, don't have good understanding of the history and the systems in the mainland, together with, the opposition parties are swaying the young people. They don't really want one country, two systems to be successfully implemented. They don't really want to see a stronger China in the world stage. And we have to understand that the opposition parties are making preparation for this. First, they're demonizing the SAR government and the central authorities, and they take advantage of the fear of the communists about the lack of freedom and the lack of protection for personal properties. Mr. Martin Lee was an alarmist in the U.S. at the hearing. He said that the U.K. government handed over 5 million Hong Kong people to China It was like the World War II. 5 million Jews were returned to the Nazis. And he said also that without amending the Basic Law to protect the interests of the people of Hong Kong, after 1997, because of political differences, there may be people who will be incarcerated for their beliefs, and people didn't have any good opinion of one country, two systems. Some sold off their own properties and left Hong Kong in droves. After the handover, after the reunification, China lived up to its end of the bargain, and Hong Kong becomes ever more prosperous than it was under the British rule. And a lot of people who emigrated regretted their decision. They're coming back to Hong Kong. After the reunification, the opposition parties were at it again. They were talking about mainland people being money-grabbing and not having any reliability. And they played up the corruption in the mainland, and opposition parties are creating this resentment against the Communist Party and the fear of the Communist Party and the people of Hong Kong, particularly the young people who don't have a good understanding of China, would feel very resentful. Whatever olive branch the mainland authorities hand to Hong Kong, they don't get they don't win the hearts and minds. The opposition parties would interpret the interpretation of the Basic Law as interference of Hong Kong affairs, and they are putting the mainland on the spot. Second, they're advocating localism. They're driving a wedge between mainland and Hong Kong. The opposition parties are playing up these uncivilized behaviors of the mainlanders, and they are painting a negative picture of the mainland people. The students, the new arrivals, they become the target of attack, and they're labeled as a locust. And all these vilification is used by the opposition parties. Over the years, in developing Hong Kong's economy, in developing the economies, the mainland leaders are vigorously cracking down down on corruption, but the opposition parties are playing this division trick, and they engage in all these violent radical measures to get rid of the mainland Chinese. Some would engage in the designification, and Hong Kong's hospitality goes out of the window. Tourism, retail, catering take a battering, and much to the detriment of Hong Kong's economy. President, Hong Kong enjoys freedom of speech. It doesn't mean to say the foreign forces can arbitrarily interfere with Hong Kong's lifestyle. We have to be discerning enough to spot the true intention of the opposition parties. We have to uphold the Basic Law and enjoy the rights conferred upon us by the Basic Law. Without the Basic Law, how can we ensure that we can implement two systems under one country? Some are seeking to amend the Basic Law or even burn the Basic Law, and this is effectively throwing out the protection that we've been enjoying. This is a dangerous move. After the resolution has been vetoed, I hope that we will face up to the reality. We should not be objecting for the sake of objection. We have to focus our attention on the economy and livelihood issues. We have to amend the rift in a way that one country, two systems can be implemented successfully in Hong Kong.
Mr. Chen Ka-piu. Thank you, Mr. Deputy. Well, this is a timely motion debate. Last week, we were here to handle a very important matter under the Basic Law, and that is the introduction of universal suffrage under Article 45. That's what the two systems means, and that is that we are different from other parts of China. We can have universal suffrage. Unfortunately, the pandemic has bundled themselves up and said no. In the past 20 months, I observed that people have been talking about implementing one country, two systems. And when there's a clear sign of advocacy of Hong Kong's independence or to tear up the basic law, the pandemic quests are ambivalent. I can hear from Mr. Dennis Kwok that he would like everyone to attach importance to the basic law. But you have to treasure the basic law as a whole. You cannot just mention one article and not another. For example, Hong Kong enjoys various rights under Article 2. But we have to look at Article 12 and Article 20. And that is the CPG can confer additional powers to the SAR. The basic law was promulgated in the 1990s. It remains the same ever since. When we want to protect ourselves, we invoke the two systems. But when you attack the CPG, you ignore the one country in the formulation. We've been saying that our system is an executive-led political system, but you cannot find the two words, the word executive-led in the basic law. And then the pandemocrats are saying that this is executive hegemony. Well, actually, it's not even executive-led. How do we compare with the British colonial government? Well, I like to take students to view the four paintings outside this chamber. The first one was Mr. Swain, the then president of LegCo. We all know that our history goes back to 150 years. But why were there only four portraits of LegCo presidents? Well, because past presidents of LegCo were all colonial governors. So there was no one country, two systems under the colonial rule. And in 1995, there was the proposal that goes against the basic structure of the transition from the colonial era to SAR. And in the past, the Court of Final Appeal for Hong Kong was the Privy Council. Now we have our own Court of Final Appeal. So apart from the CE, and then 80% of LegCo members must be Chinese citizens. There's no such requirement for the judges in our courts. So Hong Kong is able to have democracy, division of powers, and a high autonomy. That's manifested in the design of our political system. When so many people in Hong Kong doubt whether we can actually implement the one country, two systems, so Mr. Ronnie Tong has put it very aptly, when you accuse other people of distorting the basic law, you must ask yourself whether you are doing the same. Now the constitutional reform package has been vetoed and the status quo will be maintained. How can we ensure the continuance of one country systems and so that the public can be assured? I think this must be the consensus of all members here. We must respect one country. But the two systems can evolve over time. Our political system evolves, but we should not ignore that political system of the CPG is also evolving. I've received a message that the MPC is now drafting a piece of legislation saying that all leaders at all levels of the country must swear allegiance to the constitution. That means that they have to abide by the law, by the constitution. When we say that there are problems in the mainland, but we should not ignore that the mainland is making progress on various fronts. We went to the Nordic countries, and we talk about one country, two systems as practiced in Hong Kong. We have two systems. The two systems are changing over time. And the crux of the matter here is whether we can refer to common experience, shared experience. Now we face a movement of Hong Kong independence, and there are people advocating independence of Hong Kong. All political parties, all people of Hong Kong must guard against such thoughts. We should not allow such ideology to undermine one country, two systems. So I submit. Ms. Claudia Mo.
Falcon.
Last week we vetoed the fake universal suffrage package. It was a farce. It was a joke. And prompts us to the fact that one country, two systems is teetering at the brink. According to the loyalists, well, all patriots, pro-establishment members should all come and cast a support vote so that the pandemocrats, the opposition, will be singled out for a target. Maybe that mistake was an honest mistake. But after the mistake was made, their behavior was most ugly. Some said that the liaison office would not hold us accountable. And some said, I went to the liaison office to explain, that's okay. What has it got to do with one country, two systems? Well, the CPG has the power to make decisions over our constitutional reform, so that's okay. But the spirit behind the basic law is one country, two systems, and a high degree of autonomy, apart from foreign affairs and defense. We should be looking after our own affairs. But that's not what they think. Even James Tin said that going to the liaison office to explain what happened in that fiasco would be okay, because the big brother in Beijing has the final say, so it's okay to talk to them. Please think about this. Please think carefully. If that's what you think, if Beijing has the final say, of course. It's been said that if you elect a CE not acceptable Beijing, the appointment can be denied. That would be a big joke internationally. And then Beijing doesn't want to have this kind of scenario. And that is, Hong Kong people do not obey orders from Beijing, and we elect someone not acceptable to Beijing. And then Beijing can refuse to make the appointment. Well, that would be the biggest joke. That would be the biggest laughing stock of the world. Therefore, they promulgated the August 31st decision, and then no one would be able to stand as candidate
if they are not to the liking of Beijing. If you say this is related to Beijing, and then all sorts of things can be related to Beijing. But what about national education? Why not? Because it's national education. It has got to do with the nation. What about housing problems? Mr. Anthony Cheung can go to the talk to the liaison office, because it has got to do with new arrivals from the mainland. So everything is related to Beijing. So how come we can continue with a high degree of autonomy? How come we have one country, two systems, and that we can handle our own affairs apart from foreign relations and defense? I think Hong Kong people should not be so shameless and try to curry up to the power that be. Mr. Deputy, this SAR government is singly minded to promote integration of Hong Kong and the mainland. Well, we are talking about preserving our spirit of fairness, basic human rights, our democratic ideals. Well, you can't win in this argument. And then you blame the independence of Hong Kong as an ideology. And you're trying to scare off the moderates. Well, it's a means for you to marshal support. Well, I understand that Chinese people in Hong Kong, especially those who have moved to Hong Kong from the mainland, they have deep down in their mind a fear for disability and chaos. For in the past century, we have had, as a people, experience all sorts of chaos and turbulences, the civil war, the war against Imperial Japanese army. So people are so afraid of unrest. But you don't want to know the reason behind what people want. Our young people were born here. They would grow up here, they would live here, but you just brand them as useless or advocates of independence. It's just what Dr. Samuel Johnson said. Patriotism is the last refuge of a scoundrel. If you fail in the argument, you just point your finger at your adversary and say, you are advocating Hong Kong independence. Well, you should put your hand on your heart. Are you not failing our people, our next generation as well as the generation after next?
Mr. Lang Yiu-chung. Mr. Deputy, on the 10th of June last year, the Information Office of the State Council published the practice of the One Country, Two Systems policy in the Hong Kong SAR region. This publication aroused great public concern and also had political repercussions in society, because people felt that the white paper showed that Hong Kong would tighten Hong Kong's degree of autonomy, and the white paper would do a blow to one country, two systems principle. Although Beijing said openly that it was not the case, they had not received any instructions, and the policy of one country, two systems was never changed. since its implementation. Now, when we talked about one country, two systems, namely a socialist system and a capitalist system, it's true that in this regard, this principle has not changed much. Because as we all know, economic development in China recently no longer gives regard to socialism, because if they go back to socialism, it will not really be beneficial to its country, to its people. So I'm not too worried about whether it is socialism or capitalism in Hong Kong. Rather, I'm more concerned that they have too much respect for capitalism. As a result, they would defend or favor the interests of capitalists at the expense of the welfare of grassroots workers in Hong Kong. Before Siew Ai Leung assumed office, he talked about a concern for the difficulties of workers in Hong Kong. There should be standard working hours, so on and so forth. Unfortunately, many capitalists came out to oppose, and at once Siew Ai Leung shut up. He dragged his feet on matters he promised to do, and we never know whether he's going to honor his promises during his term. And we're worried that grassroots workers may see their interests affected. However, the white paper is not just about one country, two systems. It talks about the jurisdiction. It says that the central authorities has comprehensive jurisdiction over Hong Kong. Because the SAR is just like any administrative region in the country, and the central authorities has the right to cut powers delegated to the SAR. This is so worrying. Perhaps the central authorities have forgotten that we have the Basic Law and the Joint Declaration. We know that the central authorities have promised in the Sino-British Joint Declaration that Hong Kong was to be set up as a special administrative region, which will be very different from any province or municipality within the country. The SAR can be handled very differently, and that is why it is called a special administrative region. If we look at it as an ordinary province or municipality, then why should we need the adjective special administrative to describe this region? And the Basic Law was endorsed by the MPCSC. It was regarded as a constitution for Hong Kong, a mini constitution for Hong Kong. So how come you say that there is no residual power for Hong Kong? That means there is no need for the Basic Law to be amended. It is already amended by the white paper in this way, because the Basic Law states very clearly that with the exception of foreign affairs and defense, all matters are to be handled by the Hong Kong SAR government. So how come the white paper says that the central authorities has comprehensive jurisdiction? Now, we understand that we are not fully autonomous. We truly understand that. But what are the areas that the central authorities can have a say? And what are things that we have a high degree of autonomy? Everything, with the exception of foreign affairs and defense. Because in Hong Kong, we practice the common law. That means what is not written in the law can be allowed. For instance, for education, there is no mention of education in common law, in the Basic Law, so we can manage it ourselves. And housing matters, it is also within our jurisdiction. And for election of the CEO and forming of the LegCo, there is nothing in the basic law to say that the MPCSC can decide on the implementation details. It has only got a vetting power. When we want to change the method of election or formation of the CEO and the LegCo respectively, the approval of MPCSC is needed. It's okay, but the 831 decision has gone beyond that stipulation. It has added new restrictions, and this is against the basic law. So how can you say that the electoral proposals were formulated in accordance with the basic law? This is a blatant lie. And in 1993, Liu Ping said very clearly that formation of the LegCo after 2007 would be a matter for the Hong Kong SAR government. And then subsequently, it was decided that the 2007 package had to be passed before the mode, the formation, the method for forming LegCo could be discussed. I think it is eroding our high degree of autonomy. It has deprived our rights. So I think we are not talking about the original one country, two systems principle. Your time is up. Mrs. Regina Ip. Thank you, Mr. Deputy. On behalf of the